My district has consistently had the highest voter turnout in the entire Commonwealth out of all 203 districts. It is a non-gerrymandered district. In a Commonwealth that is in the top three states in terms of gerrymandering. And we'll see what our maps look like tomorrow, won't we? Maybe. I mentioned gerrymandering because I became familiar with that term as a small child. It's not something you learn in elementary school, but I learned about it from my grandmother after the passing of my grandfather. You see, he was recruited by Republicans. Yeah, Republicans. This was a long time ago. Thank you. But it's an important point. He was recruited by Republicans in the 1930s in a rural county in Kentucky to run for city council. He was the local physician to the Negro population. When Democrats found out, they were infuriated and they demanded a meeting with my grandfather. And they sought to bully him to not run because they feared he would win. And I would imagine that he would have been the first and only black person to be in that position. What my grandmother told me was that these Democrats threatened to cut their house out of the councilmanic district. And that's how I learned what gerrymandering was as a small child. These were Democrats, not Republicans. Our Republican friends like to remind us, you know, they're the party of Lincoln. Did you know that? Okay. And it was those Democrats that did X, Y, and Z. But they leave out the second half, which is why it was the collective wisdom of black folk to leave the Republican Party, because they betrayed our values, our livelihoods, our priorities. They leave that out. So when we talk about all of these awful legislative matters, I want the folks at home to think very carefully about this. Why? Why are they spending so much time on these bills when they're going to be vetoed by our governor? Why are they doing it? And if you believe your vote doesn't matter, why is the majority seeking to undermine your franchise? And it is nothing new. We just voted on a constitutional amendment yesterday, but there was a successful constitutional amendment in 1838 where the all-white state legislature came together and said, yeah, we know black men have been voting for a few decades now, but we're going to take away that franchise. That's what the Constitutional Convention was in 1838, to strip black men who were free of their right to vote. There is a long history of doing this, but it's not rigging the system, it is the system. This is how it was meant to be until we decide to speak up. So I'm going to leave you with this. Maybe this is boring to some folks, electoral, voting rights, reform. Whatever your issue is, whatever you care about, whether it's climate change or school funding, gender rights, whatever, your number one and number two issues must be electoral reform and media reform. I'm not going to talk about media reform here right now, but they're very intertwined. Anything you care about is influenced in some way by our state government and the people who are elected. If we abdicate our responsibility to hold the legislature accountable and do what's right for all Pennsylvanians, then we become part of the problem. We can do this, but only if we're informed and we work together. And I'm honored to be with my colleagues today to just bring this home, because this is an imperative.